Today's Corona Minute is brought to you by the elegantly simple, yet profoundly satisfying act of drinking ice-cold milk from a mason jar. Got milk? I clearly do.
Hello, my name is Father Jacob Rouse, and I'm the pastor of Notre Dame Parish in Cresco, Iowa. And for today's Corona Minute, I would like to continue to talk about the four Gospels and their associated animals, so that hopefully you can start to read and study and learn about and eventually fall in love with sacred scripture. I really like cows. I really like all farm animals, actually. I grew up in the city in Cedar Rapids, and so like any sort of outside farm animal thing is very fascinating and very exciting to me. But cows are especially funny to me because I think they're kind of cute. And they just slowly plod along around the lawn, eating hay and grass. They provide us with milk, with meat. And another thing about cows that I've never experienced firsthand, but my understanding is that they're very, very hard to move unless they want to. So they're kind of stubborn and they're going to go at their own pace. Okay, that brings us to the Gospel of Luke. So remember, we have Matthew the human face. We have Mark the lion, and we have today Luke the ox. These four animals come from a vision in the book of Ezekiel, and then they were used in Revelation, and then through art and time and culture, they became associated with the four Gospels to help us learn and to associate with them, to get to know them. Four perspectives, one Jesus. Also, we have on this beautiful gold-bound book that I use during Mass, this is the processional Gospels, the processional book that I walk across the altar with. It's very shiny. We bind it in gold because it is the living, beautiful Word of God that makes us rich. Also, the Alpha and the Omega, the A and Z, the beginning and the end, the first and last letter of the Greek alphabet, because Jesus is the beginning and the end. So that brings us to Luke. Why is Luke an ox? Well, one reason is the slow, plodding, stalwart pace that this gospel narrative takes. And it's slowly moving, Jesus, as the ox, is slowly moving towards Jerusalem, which Jerusalem is the city of his destiny to suffer, die, and rise and save us all. So he's moving. It's sad and it's scary, but he does not waver. He does not make that plow deviate from its course. The other reason is that the oxen is one of the highest and most expensive and most painful to lose sacrificial animals. In the old days, the Old Testament, and before Jesus, we had to sacrifice animals for our sins. Imagine having to bring two doves to the temple, or a sheep, or a goat, or a cow, or getting bigger than, the oxen. That's like your main farm equipment. So imagine having to sacrifice that to God. That's an act of trust. Imagine if you had to come to Mass and bring two shovels, or an axe, or bring a plow or a baler, I don't know what the biggest, most expensive farm equipment you can't do without. Let's say a combine. Imagine if you had to donate and sacrifice a combine to be worthy. That's kind of what's going on here. So Jesus is the most perfect sacrifice, the most expensive, the most painful one to lose, but yet he still goes and sacrifices himself anyway for our sake and for our goodness. This gospel was written in the 60s, once again, and was written, we believe, towards Gentile Christians. And you can tell a lot of this because of the way the language that Luke uses, the inclusiveness of his language. He's calling all nations to salvation. Samaritans, those dirty Samaritans, and other outcasts living outside of the Palestine-Israel area. Readers of this gospel would have been familiar with the ancient scriptures because he quotes and uses a lot of prophecies. He talks about the salvation of Israel, the salvation of the nations, but most importantly, the salvation of the whole world, including the outcasts and the downtrodden. Jesus, known as the physician, Luke the physician, spends a lot of time with lepers and blind people and outcasts, and of the society in that time would have been women and those who were sick and those without a voice. So he brings a voice for the voiceless and raises all humans up to the same level. He treats the Blessed Virgin with beautiful simplicity and sensitivity and dignity. We get a lot of our Marian theology from Luke. And there's other things that aren't in other Gospels, like Elizabeth, the Good Samaritan, the prodigal son, Jesus' boyhood, the walk to Emmaus, And finally, you know who the first evangelist is? The first evangelist is Mary Magdalene. She's the first one to run from the tomb to those scared apostles. She is the first evangelist of the resurrection of the new age. So if that's something that you were drawn to, the healing, loving parenthood of Jesus, the nurturer, and the one who brings about equality and brings about peace, this is a gospel for you. I mean, they're all for you. I recommend starting with Mark, reading through, and then going to, you know, maybe Luke. Who knows? But read one gospel passage every day. Read one psalm every day. And eventually you'll make it all the way through. So why don't you go get yourself a Bible, go look up the gospel passage for this coming weekend, and then go wash your hands.